With the dust settled from some of the hype around liquid glass and some of the more flashy elements at Apple's WWDC 2025 event, I took a step back to really look at what could be some of the most useful updates coming to their different operating systems, mainly because, quite often, there are updates or added features that we just don't use. So, in this video, I wanted to highlight a few of the things that, as a heavy iPhone, Mac, iPad, and Apple Watch user, have me excited for the full releases in the fall. And yes, Android users, I'm aware that there are often plenty of features that you've had on your phones for quite a while that are just now making it to iPhones. But rarely on either side of the argument does a new smartphone offer enough for someone to completely switch ecosystems. So, congratulations, you win. Something, I guess. The first feature addresses something that plagues us all these days, the unwanted text that often turn out to be some sort of scam. Apple's addressing this with screening tools and messages. With on-device detection, texts from unrecognized numbers that are likely spam will be filtered from your inbox. Those messages will be sent to a separate page. And even better, Apple says you'll still get the important messages that you need, like if it's a restaurant system sending a text to let you know your table's ready, or a PIN number to log into an account because you forgot your password again. Within the phone app, Hold Assist seemed to immediately generate buzz, and in theory, it's probably one of the biggest announcements of the event in terms of convenience. Now, I don't know about you, but sometimes I go out of my way to avoid doing something if I know it involves sitting on hold, waiting for customer service. So with Hold Assist, you can keep your place in line on hold on the phone and take care of anything else you need in the meantime. Then, when there's a live voice on the other end, your phone will notify you to return to the call and let the person on the other end of the call know you'll be there shortly. Fingers crossed that it works well because it sounds like a dream. Sticking with convenience, one app that we use a lot but probably overlook is the wallet, especially now that most places you go allow tap to pay. And with digital IDs and virtual car keys now, you almost don't need a physical wallet when you leave the house. So when you think about it like that, we're kind of overdue for some added functionality to that wallet app. For frequent travelers with your flight boarding passes and wallet, you'll also be able to access airport maps within the app, which is a huge help, especially during quick layovers. For online shopping, Apple Intelligence can now scan your inbox for emails from retailers or delivery services and track those orders. Now, if you're like me, there's always a privacy concern there. I certainly never registered for any of the third-party apps that do this inbox scanning, but Apple does have a pretty solid reputation for prioritizing user privacy, so I'm really not worried about it there. Past the iPhone, it's the iPad and its iPadOS 26 that probably deserve the most attention. The headliner is finally getting a more Mac-like experience with the new windowing system and customizable layout. But what caught my eye just as much is file organization, especially as a photographer that does a lot of editing on the iPad and needs to be able to save different photos to different folders and move photos between devices in a clean, organized manner. It seems minor, but having a list view where you can easily identify file types goes a long way. So does being able to add folders to the dock. So if there's a set of files that frequently need to be accessed, it's that much easier to find. It only makes sense, considering that for several years now, iPads have had a lot of the same processing power as Macs with the Apple Silicon M chips. We can run really powerful apps on the iPad, now it'll just be a bit more functional. Still not a full laptop replacement, in my opinion, if you're a power user that does a lot of video editing or advanced work, but for travel, I can take an iPad now and know that I can technically do just about everything I would if I were traveling with a MacBook instead. Also in the long overdue but super useful department, local capture for audio and video. And this is big for creators or anyone who needs higher quality recordings of meetings. Sure, you can record your Zoom or Teams meetings through their software, but it's often low quality. Now with the local capture feature on the iPad, you can record just your own video and audio with echo cancellation blocking out the other participants. Then, if you need to, you can share the higher quality clips with anyone who needs them after the meeting or interview. Finally, and this is one that I know was available elsewhere before, we've got live translation. Remember earlier when I said there's usually not a feature that would make someone jump ship from one smartphone ecosystem to another? Well, this one came close when I saw it on the Samsung S24 Ultra at the start of 2024. In typical Apple fashion, they're taking live translation and spreading it across multiple operating systems. Through Apple Intelligence, it's present in FaceTime and phone calls, through messages across multiple devices, including the Apple Watch, and even within Apple Music, there's lyric translation and pronunciation. Whether it's ordering food, talking with friends and family from a different country, or communicating across borders for work, I think this kind of thing is incredibly useful. And if nothing else, it helps Apple Intelligence catch up with some of the other AI features already offered from competitors. There, I said it. Thanks for watching, everyone. I'd love to know what you all think of the upgrades and what you're looking forward to, or what do you think Apple's still missing? Let us know in the comments, be sure to like this video and subscribe to the channel for more, and we'll see you next time.